TikTok, time to rock. Good evening, good morning, good afternoon to everyone who's watching from all over the world. I'm your friendly neighborhood philosopher, David Wood. With me now is your friendly neighborhood. What would you classify yourself as? You've got a bunch of degrees.
Probably a theologian.
Theologian.
Your yeah.
Friendly neighborhood theologian, Dr. Tony Costa. How you doing, Tony?
It's great. I'm doing well, David. It's great to be on with you tonight.
And I'm sure you've been seeing the recent meltdown.
Oh, yeah, it's huge.
And I haven't even gone into all the details of the meltdown because tomorrow, Lord willing, I'll be posting a video about Zakir Naik, where Zakir Naik is encouraging various Muslim leaders to keep databases on critics of Islam. To keep records of everything they've said about Muhammad so that if they ever cross into a Muslim country for some reason, they can be arrested, then tried and imprisoned for things they said about Muhammad. This is Zakir Naik, right? This is not some fringe weirdo, right? In Christianity, we have, you know, fringe weirdos who want to do weird things.
Sure.
But this is the most popular Muslim apologist ever. And then notice that's very similar to your... I guess he's your buddy. Ijaz is up there near you, isn't he?
Well, he's in Toronto. He's with. He's working under Shabir Ali at the Islamic Information Center. Yeah. So there was a video put out recently where he was actually doxing a Christian by the name of Ariel from down in the southern state of Florida. And that was very disconcerting, actually. And I know Paul Williams has also come out and also mentioned how this really irked him about Ijaz.
Yeah, and I mean, as it should. I mean, Ijaz has to know there are plenty of his co-religionists who want to kill and murder critics of Islam. And for him to say, oh, by the way, here's the address. And what Paul Williams actually said in his in that article. So in case anyone doesn't know, Paul Williams was, he's a Muslim, then he's not a Muslim, then he's a Muslim, then he's not a Muslim. It sounds like he's not a Muslim right now. But he said he was friends with Ijaz. And years ago, Ijaz pointed out, hey, he's keeping, as Zakir Naik suggested, a database, but he's personal details, right? So what Ijaz apparently does in his spare time is, you know, use fake accounts on Facebook and other platforms to befriend the family members of critics of Islam and evangelists and so on to learn everything he can about them. And he's keeping files on everyone for, you know, however he's going to want to use this in the future. And we saw one of the ways he decided to use it. He became angry at someone and then just says, oh, by the way, here's his address and you will be found. You will be found. Total threat. He came out and apologized, but that's only after it had the wrong impact as far as he received an overwhelming negative response from everyone. Yeah. And people were tying him to Shabir Ali because he's one of Shabir Ali's students and going after Shabir because of it. And then he came out and apologized, but this wasn't some spur of the moment temper tantrum, which you could forgive that. If someone got angry and just blurted something out, that would be one thing. But one, he had all that info already. And now we find out from Paul Williams, he's been doing that for years, gathering this info so that when he wants to come after you, he can give people a roadmap on how to execute you.
Yeah, it's pretty creepy, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's pretty creepy. And also the damage was done already. So he already put out the guy's address and he even mentioned his sister as well. So the damage is done. I mean, you can apologize, but that's like, you know, putting out information out there, putting someone's life in danger and then apologizing for it. The damage is already done.
Yep. So pretty rough stuff. So, gosh, we've got Zakir Naik and again, planning to release that tomorrow. Zakir Naik advising Muslims to keep records of everything people are saying and then to have them arrested as soon as they step inside the wrong country. We've got Sheikh Yasser Qadhi and Mohammed Hijab and that meltdown and them deleting their interviews to try and cover things up. We've got Hijab with the golden showers and all that other perverted stuff he's into. Then Hijab starts going after people's wives. So if he were to become angry at you, he would start going after your wife. Then Ali Dawa, just
yeah.
something we've been trying to tell people for years, that Islam has the
Yeah.
death penalty for apostasy, and then they
Yeah.
deny it. You're Islamophobes for saying this. Now Muslims are saying it.
Yeah.
Of course we're gonna
Yeah.
execute you when we take over. Situation with Hijaz. Then there's the collaboration where they all gather together to get critics of Islam banned from Patreon. That didn't work out very well, ladies and gentlemen. It just didn't work out very well. And if you don't believe me, I got so many friends named Andrew Jackson who are willing to testify on my behalf here. Then what else? Then you have Ali Dawa praying for
Yeah.
us to be killed. It's just a complete meltdown, right? I
Yeah.
mean, and I'm just talking a lot here at the beginning because I know I'm about to hand things over to you to go through everything you want. But in addition to who was this? This was Vidu Vids. Vidu Vids was pointing out that for a couple decades, the goal of Muslim apologists was to present themselves as these moral pillars, right? We're the moral ones.
Yeah.
We're the reasonable ones, and you guys are the immoral ones. And look how noble we are, and so
Yeah.
on. And then all of a sudden, they just shifted to, we're the strong ones, and we'll crush you all. And
yeah, it's like Bruce Banner becoming the Hulk, something like
I'm gonna steal that. I'm so gonna steal that. And what's funny is I'm not gonna credit you at all. I'm just gonna say it in a video, and people are gonna say, David, that's so brilliant that you used that. And but people who saw this will know David stole that. Oh yeah, and then people are pointing out right now. People are pointing out in the chat. Totally forgot about this, even though I posted about it yesterday. It's so many meltdowns to keep in my mind that I can't even keep track of them all. Mensch.
Yes, I was going to mention him. Yeah.
Do you remember Mensch from back in the day?
I do. Yes, I do.
That was the dude back in the day. This is before I knew much. Back when I started studying, and I would go to Answering Islam to look up topics and. Mensch was the guy everyone was responding to, him and his website and his
Yep.
team. It was like
Yep.
the Mensch team versus the Answering Islam team.
That's right.
And
yeah, he's been busted with child pornography.
Child porn, and then his response is to threaten is now he's posting pictures of himself with a knife and he's gonna do something with it. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, wow, wow. Meltdown. I'm really interested in seeing where this goes, because it's
Yeah.
like
Yeah, interesting days in which we live, David. Interesting days. But I think we're beginning to see the real face here. The cover's been blown, and we're beginning to really see the face of this politicized part of Islam. It's not just a religion. Whenever we think about Islam, we always think that it's just a religion. It is a religio-political system. There's no separation of mosque and state. And so I think that the cover is being blown, and it's truth. It's truth that is exposing all of this.
And as Louise said here, and Hatun being removed from Speaker's Corner. I said it. I'm having trouble keeping all of the meltdown in my head, where this woman who's been going to Speaker's Corner for years, it's just now she can't even, I mean, she's still going to go, but now police are advising her not to go because there's a serious death threat against her. She goes anyway. They have to kick her out to appease the crowd. Wow.
I was just on with her last night, David, on her live stream on YouTube, and I was asking her, "Are you okay?" Because it looked like the police roughed her up a little bit by grabbing her by the arm. She actually said that she didn't even feel the ground below her. I mean, she's so small; she's like a little hobbit.
Mm-hmm.
She's 5 feet, 5 feet tall or so. So I mean, she's one brave lady, but it's going to take more than that to stop her, because she's relentless.
Yeah, and it's. Yeah, so my goodness, wherever you look, it's endless meltdown. And where is it going to go from here? And what's interesting is other sort of minor things that get revealed about all of this, right? Like Hijab, so he starts going after people's wives, including all this language of like rape and torture, but qualifying it so you can't actually say it's a direct threat of rape and torture. It's just it's built into the tweet about forcing
right.
them to their knees and defiling them and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So he's doing that. And then I respond by implementing Surah 6, verse 108 of the Quran, namely, hey, if you want to stop a Muslim from insulting, just start insulting his religion even more, and he's supposed to stop, which hijab did stop right. immediately. We still got the taking down the tweets issue and so on. But when I chewed up and spit out the Quran, the entire online Dawah team really thought we finally got the dizzle. Now we can just go to all Christian apologists and Christian speakers, and they will all condemn David for what he's done. And most Christians were strangely silent, right?
Yeah.
And so what was funny was when I'm hanging out with someone, I'll ask, I'll say, hey, what are your thoughts on this? They're like, yeah, you know, I wouldn't do that and stuff. And I would say, what if they go after your wife? And every single one I talked to is like, oh, yeah, it's on then. It's on. And yep. If that's how you stop them from going after your wife, which is interesting because even that, it reveals a difference here between Christianity and Islam, that in their mind, just women aren't that important. Why are you gonna go off over a woman or your wife when Islam is so wonderful and the Quran is so wonderful? You never do anything about that. Whereas in Christianity, we're commanded to love our wives as Christ loved the church, Christ was crucified for the church. So we Christian husbands are supposed to be ready to be crucified for our wives. And then you think you're going to sit around insulting them, and I'm supposed to care more about offending your feelings and hurting your book? And oh, I could stop you from attacking all these women, from attacking everyone's wife. I could do it, but no, I respect your book too much. A book that calls me the worst of creatures and tells you can treat women like garbage and smack and beat them into submission. I don't want to offend that book. What level of delusion do you have?
Yeah. Anyway, it's that attitude, David. It's that attitude about, you know, you feed the crocodiles and you hope you're the last one that the crocodile will eat. But the thing is, they're going to eat you in the end anyway. And so you're absolutely right. I mean, Christ loved the church. He didn't just love the church. He gave himself for her. And he protects her. He cares for her. He treats her with the utmost love and grace that we actually don't deserve. But Christ is the model of how we ought to treat our wives. Absolutely. And she was worthy, not worthy, but she was someone that he was willing to pay with his own lifeblood to redeem her. And he protects her. He's the one who said, I'm going to build my church. The church is... The gates of Hades are not going to prevail against my church. And that's because he's with her, he maintains her, and he is the one who's steering the church through these critical times right now.
Yep. So, wow. Meltdown. And I really am just like, what could you guys do next? Child pornography, attacking people's wives, threatening people with death, doxing people. What are you guys going to come up with next? Wow.
Yeah. Interesting days in which we live.
I am genuinely excited to see, because now it's so amazing. Like now I can normally predict what people are going to do based on their personality types and you know what the other things that are going on. Whereas the only thing I can predict right now is more meltdown. But they've lost their mind so much that it's wild stuff.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. So what is our topic today and why is it important, Tony?
Yeah, our topic today is why Islam cannot bear criticism. And that ties into a lot of the meltdowns we've been talking about. They cannot bear criticism. And the reason why they cannot bear criticism is because their sources, their most trusted sources, the Quran, the Hadith, and the Sirah clearly tell us that Islam cannot bear criticism. And so I think we should step back and ask the question, if an ideology cannot be questioned at the pain of death, then what is there to hide? Mm-hmm. So we got that Streisand effect that we talked about before. And you know, the Greek philosopher Socrates once said, the unexamined life is not worth living. And I really believe that that also could apply spiritually or theologically. The unexamined faith is not worth believing. Mm-hmm. And so if Islam cannot stand up to scrutiny, then why do you believe it? Christianity has been scrutinized for 2,000 years. It's been attacked. The Bible's been one of the most attacked books in all of history. It's still the number one bestseller. And Christians have been vilified. Christians have been persecuted. Christians have been martyred. But the Church of Christ still goes forward. So we need to really ask this question. What type of a system shoots down any critical independent thought? And what type of a system does not allow you not only to question its prophet, you cannot question its God, and you cannot even question its book. So these are our red flags, and I hope our Muslim friends are really listening to this. Why is it that your book and your prophet and your God is beyond any scrutiny, any questions?
Yeah, and if you it would be one thing if Islam were this, you know, super nice, gentle religion, and we criticized it, and it said, why are you bothering us? We're minding our own business. We're not hurting anyone.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Islam calls for the violent subjugation of the entire world, calls Christians and Jews the worst of creatures, commands its adherents whenever they're able to violently subjugate Jews and Christians. Other people have to be killed. Muhammad said,
yeah,
I've been commanded to fight people until they say there's no God but Allah and that Muhammad is his messenger. We can see the impact Islam has on women, depending on which organization you go to and which criteria they're using. You'll find out that whatever criteria they use in terms of how bad things are for women in countries around the world, you'll find 18 out of 20 of the worst countries in the world are for women are Muslim majority countries, or you'll find 11 out of 12, something like that, whatever criteria they use. And so we see the impact Islam has on women, that we can look at Muslim countries and see how Christians are treated. We can look at what's going on in Pakistan and saying that, you know, you can have some Muslims show up, take a Christian teenage girl, go forcibly marry her, make her sign a document saying, no, I've converted to Islam. Take that to court and nothing you can do about it.
That's
in
right.
Court. Over
That's
and
right.
over and over again, we see this. And then we see, then you've got, of course, and then you've got the doxing and that, yeah, we're going to kill you when we take over. They're acknowledging it now. And and what we hear from them is as soon as we say, actually, we don't believe it, we're going to challenge you on that. It's, why can't the government step in here and shut these people down for saying this about our religion? Why can't why can't YouTube and Facebook and Twitter shut these people down so that they're not allowed to criticize our ideology? It's like, guys, your ideology started it.
Yeah.
Allah and Muhammad talked about us way before we said a word about Allah and Muhammad. So it's like it's like they're saying, hey, our ideology calls for your annihilation, your destruction, the destruction of your civilization, the subjugation of your women, the sexual enslavement of your women and daughters, but don't say anything about it.
Right.
It's insane. Right. It's absolutely
and
insane.
And it's also an eternal ideology, right, David? Because remember, the Quran pre-existed on the heavenly tablets before Allah.
Mm-hmm.
And so this ideology is part of the eternal Kalimatullah, the eternal word of Allah. And so it's not just some ideology that just happened to be revealed in the 7th century in Saudi Arabia. It's an ideology that is believed to have been inscribed from eternity before Allah. And so it's part of his eternal Sharia, his eternal law.
Yep, absolutely. And wait, let me read this comment right here. Sarah said, Hatun is a strong woman and an inspiration. We need more women like her going against Islam. She's the goat of Christian apologist women against Islam. I actually think she's the only one. No, there are some other Christian apologists even out there at Speaker's Corner and so on. There are a lot of women. But yeah, I would agree that Hatun is the GOAT. In case you're in a place in the world that doesn't use that, the GOAT stands for greatest of all time. Greatest of all time. And Hatun, that is a good description of Hatun. But yeah, I especially think we need plenty of women apologists, but on the one hand, to talk to women, right? Because lots of Muslim women aren't going to want to talk to me or you, Tony.
That's right.
So it's helpful when there are women apologists. But also, if it's in a public place where, you know, the woman has some people around to protect her from a crowd, as Hatun does. And I take my hat off to the guys who stand there with her in the midst of a violent crowd. There's something interesting about it when it's a woman who's standing there in the face of the men, given what Islam teaches about the inferior intellects of women, when it's a woman like Hatun, and you've got dozens of Muslim men and apologists, and they're cowering in fear and saying, can you remove her? Can you remove her? And she will walk up to these guys who have entire Dawah teams and say, Guys, explain the holes in the narrative. Explain to me why you tell people perfect preservation, and yet your scholars are admitting there are holes in the narrative. Just explain it. All I want you to do is explain that for me, and they run. They run. And so there's just something more powerful about a woman who, again, according to
Oh,
Islam, has an
definitely.
inferior intellect,
Definitely.
and guys running from her. It's got to have a massive psychological impact on these guys.
And yet it's interesting that it was actually a woman that actually, when you think about it, really got Muhammad going. It was Khadija who confirmed his revelation, says, "Don't worry about it. This is not a jinn that's possessing you. This is the same revelation Moses got." And in fact, my cousin here, Waraka, he's going to come and actually tell you that this is all copacetic. And then again, as you know, David, the in Khaybar, when that Jewish woman humiliated Muhammad by feeding him a poisoned lamb, which eventually did lead to his untimely death, the poison, which he also admitted was the cause of his pain and so forth. So here you have a woman who basically starts Islam, his first wife, Khadija. And then you have this woman in Khaybar, this Jewish woman, after having her family massacred and then raped as a concubine, she ends up humiliating him by bringing about his untimely death. And now you've got, you know, Hatun, a 5 foot woman in London, England, who's basically got these guys running scared and getting the police to try to stifle free speech. And that is central here, folks. You really need to understand this. Freedom of speech is the bulwark, the foundation of Western society. And for this to happen in England, which is considered, when you think about in the 1200s, the Magna Carta, that constitution of the people, the voice of the people, and so forth. That is the bulwark of West society. Once that is gone, you've got nothing to stand on. So we need to defend this, David.
And what really, I mean, it never ever ceases to amaze me. It's because it's on the level of the individual in Islam and the collective as well. Islam, when it has the power, is we're strong, we'll crush you, we'll take your women, we'll take your children, we'll slaughter your men, we're strong. Rah! And then as soon as they're in a position of weakness, it's, oh, we're victims. Will everyone protect us? UN, will you protect us? And will everyone come and protect us? Will you protect us from the Jews? Will you protect us from the Christians? Will you protect us from the atheists? YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, will you all protect us? Will you shut these guys down? We're so weak and soft. But so you have that, and that's what comes across with the ideology. But then you have individual like apologists and speaker, like, you know, Muhammad Hijab, Ali Dawa, all these guys. Muhammad Hijab, me strong, me crush your wives, golden showers, me strong. And as soon as you respond, Patreon, will you kick him off? YouTube, will you delete his account? They turn into these crybabies, and it's just this. And what's amazing is, it goes back to their prophet. Their prophet was like this. When he's the persecuted prophet in Mecca, guys, what are you doing? Hey, let's all get along. No, let's not hurt each other. As soon as he gets power, I crush you all. Muhammad, you all die. I take your women.
Bruce Banner and the Hulk. And then they go from being the Hulk back to Bruce Banner again.
Did you come up with that yourself, or did you get that from somewhere?
I just came up with it right now.
Oh, good, good, good.
It was it's an intuition.
Because when I steal it from you and then I use it and then everyone thinks it's my awesome intuition, I wanted to ask because I want to be like, oh, Jay Smith uses that.
No, that's me.
All right, cool. All right, well, we know what our topic is, and we've had a good bit of introduction here. So I know you've been studying this for years, so let me ask you, why is it that Islam can't handle criticism?
Because what it fears is the truth itself. Because what you find, David, is when the truth comes out, Muslims begin to leave Islam. Remember, Yusuf al-Qaradawi actually admitted that was it not for the law of apostasy, Islam would have failed. It would have ceased to exist. And so the fear that is placed over our Muslim friends is that if you question the prophet, if you insult him, if you question Allah, if you question this book, then your destiny is the hellfire. And so it's basically control. It's no different than an abusive relationship where an abusive spouse will use violence and threats to keep the wife silent and quiet. Don't go to the police. If you do this, this is what's going to happen. And therefore, the ideology of Islam is restrictive by nature. You cannot question it in a critical sense. And therefore, when you look at this ideology, and remember, David, ideologies have no feelings. So we can criticize ideologies until the cows come home. Ideologies don't have any feelings. We're not here to attack Muslims as human beings, because we recognize human beings as image bearers of God. They bear the divine image and so forth, and we call them to repentance in Jesus Christ. And so what we need to be aware of is you have this word Islamophobia, and I'm sure you've heard it many, many, many times. It's an oxymoron. It's a moronic statement, because the whole idea of a phobia is an irrational fear. Now, you and I don't have an irrational fear of Islam. We have a rational concern here about jihad, and we have a rational concern about threats against people's wives and so forth and so on. But how different is this from the Bible? And we're going to look at some examples today where even Jesus, in the midst of controversy and in the midst of strife, Jesus did not react by shutting down his disciples, telling them to shut up. He actually teaches them to love their enemies. He actually teaches them to be gracious to those who oppose them and persecute them. So the very
Let me
sources of Islam teach us that.
yeah, well, I just wanted to add a brief comment here on that Islamophobia, because during a couple of recent live streams, we've talked about how the meaning of this term has apparently changed. So 10 years ago, 15 years ago, we would say, hey, Islam says that apostates must be killed. Islam says, and we point out all these things that Islam says, and the response was, oh, no, it doesn't teach these things. You're Islamophobes, right? We'd say, hey, Islam says that, we don't have the right to freedom of speech. Islam is going to undermine our rights. Islam calls for our subjugation. Islam says that apostates must be killed. Islam has a low view of women. And the response was, no, it doesn't. You have this phobia, Islamophobia, and it's causing you to completely misunderstand Islam, even though we were misunderstanding it in the exact same way it's misunderstood in Muslim majority countries. But the claim was, you're wrong about Islam, and it's because you have this mental disorder. Whereas now it's completely changed because Islam's top apologists are all saying what we've been saying for years, right? Of
Right. Now, very
course we're going
topical.
to subjugate you. Of course we're going to take away your right to speak. Of course apostates are going to be killed. Of course all of these things. Yes, we're going after your wives. Of course we're coming for your wives and children. Of course we are. But if you say anything about it, you're an Islamophobe. So now whereas before it's you're wrong and it's because you're an Islamophobe, it now it's yes, you guys are correct in everything you're saying, but if you resist at all, we're going to call you an Islamophobe because you don't want to be subjugated and don't want your rights to be taken away.
And so it's really a term, David, as you know, to stifle free speech. And so no one wants to be called, an Islamophobe, because that's seen as, well, and they associate it with racism, which is, again, moronic as well, because Islam is not a race. It's a worldview, it's an ideology. But these are simply political terms that have been used to simply shut down debate, like you and I are having right now. And again, it goes back to what we're saying today. Islam cannot bear to be criticized.
And as you pointed out, and guys, this is Tony's going to go through a lot of information, and we'll be given examples here, but notice everything comes down to control, right? It's if you're in a Muslim country, then we will control what you can say, but with blasphemy laws, by throwing you in jail or by executing you, we'll control you that way. Oh, you're in a Western country? We have to control you in a different way. We'll do it through terrorist attacks, as we had with the Charlie Hebdo massacre. Notice what that was. That was an attempt to control what papers and so on will publish, right? That was an attempt to control it. For people who don't want to go the route, who don't want to go that route, it can be, just heaping abuse on people. Oh, you're an Islamophobe. You're a bigot. You're a hate monger. You're a racist if you say anything about Islam. That's to control people. If that's not working, well, let's go after your wives, as Muhammad Hijab did. We'll heap abuse on your wives. Maybe if you're not concerned about your own personal safety, you'll at least be concerned about the honor of your wives. And so we'll control you that way. Oh, that's not working. Oh, let's start doxing you, right? Let's start doxing you. We'll share your personal information so that people are going to come and kill your families. All of this, it's the exact same idea. Our ideology calls you for your violent subjugation, and we want you to shut up about it while we subjugate you. We want you to keep your mouth shut, and we'll do pretty much anything to shut you up. And so all of this is the exact same principle. It's just people trying to figure out different ways
exactly
of doing
right.
the exact same thing. One quick question here, just because this will be gone in a second. Jim Farm said, "Hey David, did you watch the movie Infidel yet? Did you hear about the movie Infidel, Tony?"
I have heard of it. I haven't had a chance to watch it yet, but I've heard some very good reviews.
Yeah, I don't know. I saw it was a limited release in theaters, nothing near me. So I don't know, guys, is that available online? Because I want to see it. That's the Jim Caviezel one, right?
Yeah. Yeah. He did The Passion.
Yeah. So Jim Caviezel, apparently it's about persecution of Christians in Muslim countries.
Yeah.
And so it's just awesome that they're doing an entire movie on that. I looked at Rotten Tomatoes like a day or two ago, and it was at like 60%.
Okay.
So and I know that there are lots of people, and some of the reviews were just like, oh, it's painting a negative view of, you know, of how things are in the Middle East.
Yeah, as usual. Yeah.
Yeah. So but yeah, totally interested in seeing it. If you know that it's available somewhere where I can buy it and watch it on my TV, since there are no theaters around here that are playing it, I'd be happy to go do that. And I'd love to do a review of the film, because it's really cool that someone is drawing attention to what's going on in the Muslim world as far as Christians are concerned. All right, Tony, back to you.
Okay, so I'm going to go through a couple of passages in the Quran, and then we can maybe chit-chat about them. So the first one, Surah 4, verse 65, "But know by your Lord they have no faith until they make you, O Muhammad, judge in all disputes between them, and find in themselves no resistance against your decisions, and accept them with full submission." So Muslims have no faith until they make Muhammad the judge in all disputes, and that includes religious disputes, and they find in themselves no resistance. They cannot resist his decisions, but they must accept them with full submission, full surrender. So in this text, it's very clear in the Quran that if you want to be a Muslim and have faith and practice faith, Muhammad must be your judge in all disputes. You have to look to him, no resistance whatsoever. In the same surah, chapter 4, verse 80, "He who obeys the messenger has indeed obeyed Allah, but he who turns away, then we have not sent you, O Muhammad, as a watcher over them." So to obey Muhammad is to obey Allah. So sometimes it's like Socrates and Plato. You know what I'm talking about, right, David, in the dialogues? Is it Socrates or is it Plato? So in the Quran, when Muhammad speaks, Allah speaks. When Allah speaks, it's Muhammad speaking. There's an interconnectedness there. And then, of course, in Surah 9, the marching orders of the Quran, verse 61, "And among them," that is the opponents of the prophet, "among them are men who hurt the prophet and say he is lending his ear to every news. He believes everything he hears. Say he listens to what is best for you. He believes in Allah, has faith in the believers, and is a mercy to those who believe." But notice the last verse. "But those who hurt Allah's messenger will have a painful torment." And so to hurt the prophet, the messenger, will result in you facing hellfire. You will face a painful torment. If you hurt the prophet, how do you hurt the prophet? By insulting him, by mocking him, and so forth. And then in chapter 33, Surah 33, verse 36, "It is not for a believer, man or woman, when Allah and his messenger have decreed a matter, that they should have any option in their decision. And whoever disobeys Allah and his messenger, he has indeed strayed in a plain error." So notice again, when Allah and his messenger make a decision on any given matter, it is not for a Muslim, a man or woman, to say anything. And whoever disobeys Allah and his messenger, they have gone into error. You were going to say, David?
Oh, yeah. I was just going to point out, because, you know, I usually begin my talks on Islam by pointing out, right? I mean, Islam means submission, right?
Yeah.
Submission. Yeah. And as you quoted Surah 4, verse 65 and 33, 36, you don't get to question anything said or decided by Allah and Muhammad.
Right.
In 465, Allah goes so far as to say, if you find any resistance within yourself, you're not even a real Muslim.
That's right.
So, I mean, this is like this. I mean, this is what Islam means by submission. It means completely, mindlessly accepting anything Muhammad and Allah said. And why I find that interesting is because, by that standard, most Muslims that I know do not count as Muslims, right? They would.
Right.
Muhammad repeatedly warned against the sin of bid'ah or innovation, right?
Right.
Coming up with your own understandings and your own way of doing things. Almost every Muslim I know, no, my good man. Muhammad didn't have sex with a 9-year-old girl. She was 18 at the time, right? They're just inventing this as they go along. Great. Muhammad decided, and Allah decided in Surah 65,
Yeah.
verse 4, they
Yeah.
decided it's perfectly
Yeah.
acceptable to have sex with a
Yeah.
prepubescent
Yeah.
girl. Your leaders and
Yeah.
apologists, no, my good man, that's not the case at all. And so what am I supposed to understand there? Either you're lying in order to deceive me, or you've just invented
Yeah.
your own version of Islam all the way down. By the way, that's another example. That's another difference, right? You go back
That's right.
10, 15 years ago, we were saying, hey, Islam allows sex with 9-year-old girls. No, you Islamophobe. Islam doesn't do that at all. That's your bigotry and your racism coming through. Now almost everyone's saying it. Right? Shabir still not,
Yeah.
Shabir still won't,
You know?
but
No.
Sheikh Yasser Qadhi said you're a liar. He said you're
That's
just he
right.
just said you're a liar if you deny this. You're just a liar.
Yeah.
Stop lying, right? You've got
Right.
Ali Dawa said that if his daughter got reached the age of puberty at 9 years old, he'd tell her you're ready for marriage, right?
Yep.
So
Yep.
now once again they're saying what we were saying 10 and 15 years ago, and we were called
Yep.
Islamophobes for saying.
Yep.
Now they're saying,
Yep.
yes, of course, we will
Yep.
completely rewrite the books and say that you can have sex with 9-year-old girls. But if you
Yeah.
disagree with us, you're an Islamophobe.
Yeah.
You're
So
an Islam.
now they're Islamophobes, Dave, according to their own standards 10 years ago. So now they're Islamophobes calling us Islamophobes. So
Yeah,
there goes the chaos.
I could say that. I could say Muslims today are Islamophobes by 2010 standards.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Okay, let me
But,
go
oh,
on.
just
You
let
want
me
to go on, David?
let me address
Yep.
one comment
Yep.
here.
Sure.
From Slam RN said David Infidel is free to watch on Amazon Prime. Slam RN, if you could give me the link because I just looked it up after you posted that. And
Awesome.
there is a film called Infidel, but it's a couple years old. It's not the same.
Okay.
It's not the same film. So I couldn't find the Jim Caviezel 2020 film on Amazon Prime. So if you've got a link for that, I'd be interested in that. All right, back to you, Tony.
Okay, so Surah 33, verse 57. Verily, those who malign Allah and His Messenger, notice again the close association with Allah and His Messenger. Sounds a lot like shirk. But verily, those who malign Allah and His Messenger, Allah has cursed them in this world and in the hereafter and has prepared for them an abasing punishment. So notice it says two things here, David. If you malign Allah and His Messenger, what has Allah done? They're already cursed in this world and in the hereafter. And so this is like double jeopardy. This is the daily double here. You get punishment here and you get punishment in the afterlife just for maligning them. And then in Surah 33, again, verse 60, now we're getting back to the hypocrites you were talking about, David, Muslims who aren't really actually following Islam. It says, if the hypocrites and those in whose hearts is a disease, that is evil desire for adultery, etc., and those who spread false news among the people in Al-Madinah cease not, we shall certainly let you overpower them. That is Muhammad, you will overpower them, and they will not be able to stay in it as your neighbors in Medina, but a little while. Accursed wherever found, they shall be seized and killed with a terrible slaughter. So there's the face of jihad there. And then we look at the hadith literature, and it completely agrees with what we've seen. So Bukhari, Volume 1, Book 3, Hadith 106, narrated Ali, the Prophet said, "Do not tell a lie against me, for whoever tells a lie against me," and in parenthesis it says intentionally, "then he will surely enter hellfire." So think about this. If Muhammad is just a man, we keep hearing a Muslim friend say, we believe Muhammad was only a man. We don't treat him like you Christians treat Jesus as the God-man and so forth and so on. But yet, according to Islam's most reliable sources, like al-Bukhari, Bukhari's hadith tells us that Muhammad said, whoever tells a lie against me, he will enter the hellfire. So that sounds a lot like blasphemy against God, like something you'd see, for example, in the Old Testament. And then we have the story in Sahih Bukhari, volume 9, number 2934, the story of Uqba, who harassed and mocked Muhammad in Mecca. And he wrote derogatory verses about him. Remember, he was captured at the Battle of Badr in the AD 624. And what did Muhammad do? He ordered him to be executed. And so when this man was caught and ready to face execution, remember what he said to Muhammad. He says, "But who will look after my children, O Muhammad?"
Hell.
And Muhammad's answer was, "Hell." Mm-hmm. And they put the sword through him. We have other examples, David. The blind man, of course, that blind Muslim fellow who his wife, who was also his slave, he had two children with her. She used to abuse the prophet and verbally mock him and so forth. And he was basically telling her to stop. Stop offending my prophet. So what does he do? We're told, according to Sahih Abu Dawud, volume 3, number 4348, one night she began to slander the prophet and abuse him. So he, the blind man, took a dagger, placed it on her belly, and pressed it and killed her. A child who was between her legs was smeared with the blood that was there. So the next morning, he tells Muhammad about what Muhammad's informed about this murder. And he asks to know who is it that did this, who killed this woman. And the blind man came forward, said, "Look, I had two sons by her, but she kept abusing you and she wouldn't desist." And so when he admitted that he's the one who actually killed her, what was Muhammad's response? Muhammad's response was, "Oh, be my witness, no retaliation is payable for her blood." So no punishment for killing this woman simply because she mocked Muhammad and derided Muhammad.
Yeah, guys,
course, go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to pause on that one because that's passage from Sunan Abu Dawud is extremely important here. Guys, did you catch that? So this is a man. This man had a slave girl, So the man's a Muslim. His slave girl's not a Muslim, but she had had children. He had impregnated her. She had children who were his, and she keeps insulting Muhammad at home, right? She's saying, "How can you believe in that guy? What a weirdo. This guy's the weirdest dude around. Oh my goodness, what kind of prophet walks around covered in semen? What kind of prophet goes around sucking on little kids' tongues?" Right? We don't know what points she was bringing up, right? But probably some of the same stuff we would bring up today. There's no way this guy's a prophet. Come on. Mm-hmm. And in response, this guy stabs her to death. The blood leaks. The blood from her leaks on one of her kids. And then the guy leaves the body outside somewhere. They find the body. And then it becomes, who did this? Muhammad's all concerned. Oh my goodness, there's been a murder. There's been a murder. We have to get to the bottom of this. There must be justice. There must be justice. Allah wants justice. The guy comes forward and said, "Yeah, but she was talking trash about you, Muhammad." Mom's like, "Okay, never mind. Never mind about all that punishment stuff. She deserved it. She was making fun of me." And then people wonder, wait a minute. How can these terrorists be going and killing cartoonists for making fun of Muhammad? Guys, do you read the sources? It's right there. You see it in the Muslim sources. She's making fun of Muhammad. It doesn't even matter if it's the mother of your children. You brutally murder her for talking about Muhammad, let alone some cartoonists, some French cartoonists. So, rough stuff.
Yeah. And you know, this story has actually justified some Muslim commentators and translators to prove that non-Muslims can be killed for insulting Muhammad. She was not a Muslim. Mm-hmm. And so what the story does is it lays a precedence that if you are a non-Muslim and you insult Muhammad, you can be killed. And you know the story of Muhammad's scribe, Abdul bin Sa'd, David, who, when Muhammad was receiving revelation, he would come up with, why don't you write it this way? And Muhammad's like, "Hey, you know what? That sounds great. Let's go with that."
I'm planning on making a video about that this way. I've always wanted to make a video about it. I brought it up in various, we've talked about it in live streams and back when we did the show, Jesus or Muhammad. But I realize such an easy point to make because there are Muslim commentaries on the Quran, which actually include this story. So I've always wanted to make a quick video about it. So yeah, I'm planning on doing it this week, actually.
Yeah, very good. And al-Badawi actually commented on that, on why he became an apostate. And I think he's one of the unsung editors of the Quran. He's one of those editors that we don't give much attention to. And you know the story when Muhammad invaded Medina, he was one of the people he wanted dead, because he basically says, look, if I can come up with some ideas from Muhammad's book, then what makes him any better of a prophet than I am? I can outdo Allah's revelation.
Yeah, let me pause right there, guys. This is not according to us. This is according to Muslim sources, right? Muhammad, so he had his scribes, right? They would write it down on, paper wasn't always easy to come by. So they would write the Quran. Muhammad would so you think about the so Allah gives it to Gabriel. Gabriel gives it to Muhammad. Muhammad recites it. And he would have some people write it down on on stones or bones
whatever they can
or
find,
leaves. But the idea was that they're more along the lines of aids to memory, right? They're not trying to put together a stack of shoulder blades as a book, right? It's just, hey, if we can write this down, then I can take this back to my tent and it will be easier to memorize, as long as, for people who could read. So Abdullah ibn Abi Sa'r was one of Muhammad's early scribes. Eventually, Abdullah ibn Abi Sa'r left Islam, right? He left Islam. He apostatized, which is strange, because every time someone apostatizes today, they say, oh, he was never a Muslim. Well, that was one of Muhammad's original scribes. And they asked him, why did you leave Islam? How could you leave this wonderful religion? And his response was, because when Muhammad's receiving his revelations and he tells me, what to write down, and I'll say, wouldn't it be better this way? Muhammad says, yeah, it would be better that way. Put it this way. And Muhammad will be given a revelation, and I'll blurt something out, and Muhammad will say, oh, that's good. That's good. Write that in there too. And he said, if he's a prophet, then I'm a prophet. Because part of the revelation of the Quran came from me. It's something I blurted out, something I suggested. So if he's a prophet, I'm a prophet. And I know I'm not a prophet, so he's not a prophet, right? And so he left Islam, and Muhammad was very angry over that. And so what happened after that, Tony?
Well, yeah, so he invades Medina, and he's one of the people who have they've got a target on their forehead. Muhammad wants him out because of what you just described, David. But because Uthman was related to him, he was like an adopted brother of sorts. Uthman begged Muhammad, please spare him, maybe he's not altogether there in his head, have mercy on him, give him clemency. Well, Muhammad didn't initially grant that clemency. Muhammad started basically, pointing with his eyes, most likely, kind of saying like, take this guy out. And they didn't figure out what he was saying. And then at the end, he says, why didn't one of you guys kill him? And they said, well, Messenger of Allah, why didn't you just tell us? He says, it's inappropriate for a prophet to give eye signals and head nods and so forth. So he spared him because of Uthman, only because of Uthman there. But then again, David, there's Umar. Umar even admitted that some of his words got into the Quran. And so it's not just Abdullah ibn Sa'd, it's also the companion Umar that got some of his words in the Quran. But check this one, David. This is from Sahih al-Bukhari, Volume 2. Book 24, number 555. It says here that Al-Mughira wrote, I heard the prophet saying, Allah has hated you for three things. So number one, vain talks, that is useless talk. You talk too much about others. This is gossip. Number two, wasting of wealth by extravagance. But notice number three in particular, and asking too many questions in disputed religious matters, or asking others for something except in great need. So notice there's three things that Allah hates, that He has hated Muslims for. Number one, for gossip. Number two, being extravagant in their wealth, and asking many or too many questions. Now think about this. Why would Allah hate you for asking too many questions? I mean, wouldn't Allah, who's all-knowing, omniscient, wouldn't He know the answer to your questions? And is it not human to ask questions and to say why? I mean, all of us who are parents, what's one of the most common words from our kids' mouths? Why? Why? Why is this so? Why does this happen? Why is this the case? So it's interesting that the God of Islam actually hates you for asking too many questions. And what does that imply? The implication is you don't ask questions. Listen and obey. Surrender with full submission. you should have no resistance to any of the judgments that Allah and the Prophet put down. And then finally, David, I'll end with this one. Bukhari, Volume 1, Book 3, Hadith 91. We're told there that a man came to the Prophet and started asking him a number of questions. And then when he asked him a question about Allah's camel, it says, on that, the Prophet got angry and his cheeks or his face became red. Now, as you know, David, people only get red-faced either when they're absolutely humiliated or embarrassed, or when they become intensely angry. Notice Muhammad would get angry when some guy just asked him a question about a lost camel. Now, think about that. Why? I mean, was Jesus angry when his disciples asked him to interpret parables and to explain certain things? No, Jesus was more than happy to oblige and explain. So really, at the end of the day, I think we need to ask the question, why is it that Islam cannot bear criticism? I think it's pretty obvious. It's because the Quran and the Hadith, the twin pillars of Islam's primary authority, forbid Muslims and anyone else by extension from asking questions of the Prophet, of Allah, and of the Quran. And so, David, this is why Islam today is melting down, because the questions are being asked and the answers, as Qadi said about the Quran, the standard narrative has holes in it. And so this is why there's this reaction to criticizing Muhammad with Aisha, for example, and the textual variants in the Quran and so forth. And folks, the fact of the matter is, when we compare this with the Bible, oh, what a difference. When we look at the Bible, what do we find? Isaiah 1:18, the Lord says, come, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are red as scarlet, they shall be white as wool. Though they're red as crimson, they shall be white as snow. Notice what the Lord says. Come, let us reason together. God is not afraid of your questions. He's got a big chin. Allah has a glass chin. So does his prophet. But God invites us to come. He doesn't strike down Job for asking questions when he's in agony and pain. And Jeremiah, when he brings his complaint before the Lord and complains to God, where are you? Why is this happening? The Lord doesn't strike him dead. He doesn't threaten hellfire on him. And looking through the Psalms, how many oftentimes we read the Psalms, where are you, Lord? Why do you hide your face from us? Why do the wicked prosper and the righteous suffer? God doesn't strike the psalmist down for asking questions. Or even look at Jesus. I mean, in Luke chapter 9, the disciples are going through Samaria, and it tells us there that the Samaritans opposed them and wouldn't let Jesus cross through the territory of Samaria. You know what the disciples did? Hey, do you want us to call down fire from heaven and let's destroy them? What does Jesus do? He turns around and he rebukes them for threatening these alleged enemies of Judaism. And then, of course, in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Simon Peter does the right thing by defending his master against the authorities by arresting him, he takes out that knife and goes to strike the servant of the high priest. What does Jesus say? He says, put away your sword. Put away your sword. Those who live by the sword, they will die by the sword. What a different reaction. You know, the book of Habakkuk, I really encourage you guys, read the book of Habakkuk in the Old Testament. There's only 3 chapters. And the prophet complains. He sets his complaint before God. And the Lord answers him. He doesn't answer him by saying, how dare you question me? How dare you question the Torah? The Lord responds to him and gives them hope and tells them to find his answers in him. The God of the Bible is not afraid of your questions. He made your little three-dimensional brains. He knows what you're thinking before you think it. But the God of Islam doesn't want questions. He wants full submission, no questions asked. And that, folks, is not what God created us to be. Jesus says, I have come so that you might have life. You will know the truth. And the truth will set you free. He did not come to put us in a box. He did not come to put us into chains. He came to set the captives free. And Muslims, our Muslim friends, Christ has come, and he has come to set you free. And all you have to do is turn to him, repent of your sins, trust him that he died in your place on the cross of Calvary, and that he was raised again from the dead. And the freedom that we have in Christ, the Bible says, do not let anyone place you under the yoke of bondage, but stand fast in the freedom wherewith Christ has set you free. And that's why David and I could come here today and say, you want to question the Bible? Give us your best shot. Bring it on. We have no problems with that. And we're not going to threaten you. Jesus Christ will not threaten you. But God says, come on, let's talk. Let's talk it out. Let's reason together. What a difference, David.
Huge, huge difference. Notice all the Dawah teams. Hey, accept this religion. You say, yeah. Hey, well, I got a problem with, some of the things this teaches. Then you're an Islamophobe and we will silence you. Wow. Actually, we could take questions for a while, but I like the idea of having some hour-long live streams to see how viewership changes, because I know I'm much more likely to click on an hour-long live stream than on a two-hour live stream. Plus, I'm scheduled to go live again tomorrow and I think twice on Saturday. So I think we'll address a couple final issues and then go ahead and close out.
Sure.
We had some people asking about the sources. So P123AO says, this was on the issue of Abdullah ibn Abi Sar. Mm-hmm. So he says, where did he say that, you dumb nerds? let me give a quick rundown. I'm going to post a link to everyone who's asking, and there were multiple people who were asking for source. I'm going to post a link to an article on Answering Islam because it has the quotation that you referred to. You referred to a quotation from by Dawi. And if you want to go to a Muslim site and look up some more info. So I just included a link to an Answering Islam article right there. But in case you're doubting, you can the relevant verse as far as what we're talking about here is Surah 23, verse 14 of the Quran. Now, matter of fact, let me go ahead and read the verse for you. So I'll read the M.H. Shakir translation, Surah 23, verse 14. Then we made the seed a clot. Then we made the clot a lump of flesh. Then we made in the lump of flesh bones. This is wrong, by the way. This is nonsense scientifically. Then we clothed the bones with flesh. Now notice, first, you're going through embryonic development here. First you become bones, and then your flesh develops and covers the... This is wrong. This is absolute nonsense if you've studied the development of the fetus. Then we caused it to grow into another creation. So blessed be Allah, the best of creators. So notice, you have all of this supposed teaching about how a baby develops. And then you have, so blessed be Allah, the best of the creators. That part right there, so blessed be Allah, the best of creators. That didn't come from Muhammad's revelation. That came from Abdullah ibn Abi Sar.
That's right.
Muhammad's supposedly receiving this revelation, and Ibn Abi Sar just blurts out, "So blessed be Allah, the best to create." And Muhammad says, "Yeah, include that in there. Include that. I like that." And if you don't believe me, you can go to altafsir.com. If you want a Muslim website, go to altafsir.com. Altafsir, altafsir.com. Go to the tafsirs, and I'll just include this in a video later, but go to the tafsirs, look up that verse, Surah 23, verse 14, and then go to Asbab al-Nuzul by al-Wahidi. It's a Muslim commentary. He gives the historical background. Asbab al-Nuzul is a Muslim source that gives the historical background on verses of the Quran, gives the context of the revelation. He gives the background of that. So why would you, where does he say that, you dumb nerds, all over your sources?
If I could also provide, it also appears in the Sirah of Ibn Ishaq. So The Life of Muhammad by Alfred Gollum, and it's found on page 550. So if you go to the Sirat Rasulullah, The Life of the Messenger of Allah by Ibn Ishaq, go to page 550. And you could find the whole account there as well.
Mm-hmm. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we've been going an hour now, so we're going to go ahead and wrap things up here. Oh, Tony, you have something. You have a course coming up, don't you?
Yes, we do. Yeah, I. You want me to explain a little bit?
Yeah. Go ahead, break that down.
Yeah, so starting October the 4th, we're going to be running a course that runs for 8 Sundays, 8 consecutive Sundays. It begins Sunday evening, October 4th. At 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And I'm teaching that course. It's called The Necessity of Scripture in the Christian Life. And it's a seminary level course, but it's adapted to people who want to expand their knowledge of the Bible, how to properly read the Bible in context. That's important from the point of view of Muslim outreach, because we need to understand context is king here when it comes to interpreting scripture. That applies to the Bible as much as it applies to the Quran. But this course is designed to teach Christians how to read the Bible in context, proper exegesis, that is reading out of scripture what it says, not putting in our own ideas in there. And as I pointed out, it is seminary level, but I've adapted it for people who may be mature students of scripture. This is not a credit course. This is simply a course to expand your knowledge. And we host that Sunday evening starting October 4th. It goes till November 29th, and it is Sunday evenings from 7 p.m. to 9:30. And the fee for that is $99 Canadian. So if you're in the United States, you'll be paying much less because of the conversion rate and the fact that the Canadian dollar has been doing terribly. If you want more information, we do have a Facebook page. If you go to Facebook, look at Tony Costa. There's information there. There's a promo video there. So we welcome you along. Anyone's welcome. If you're in the U.S., some people are joining us in the U.K. We had students as far away as India. So you are welcome to join. Just send me an email at torontoapologetics@gmail.com. torontoapologetics@gmail.com.
Yeah, and Tony, if you want to send me a link afterwards, I'll include that link in the description box. So, guys, you can,
sure.
By the time most of you are watching this, not the people who are watching it right this second, but any of you who are watching it afterwards, I'll have the link in the description box. And, Tony, if you want to send a commercial about that, I'll go ahead and post that as well. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thanks to Tony for joining us and sharing his thoughts on the epic meltdown of Islamic apologetics that's going on all around us, and Islam's inability to withstand criticism. You think about how this has played out. Muhammad had no evidence to show that he's a prophet. He relied on people's ignorance, right? When he said, oh, I'm mentioned in the Bible, he's talking to people who don't know what's in the Bible, right? He appealed to their ignorance. He relied on their ignorance. By the time people could refute him, you'd get your head chopped off. This has been going on for 14 centuries. You can't question it because there's no evidence for it. So it has to be built into the system not to question it. Well, we need to use our freedom to question it, to challenge it, to show Muslims the truth. That's what we'll be doing. That's what we'll be doing tomorrow, the next day, and as long as we're here. So, catch everyone tomorrow. Should have a video up tomorrow during the day and another live stream tonight. Catch y'all later.